banks, whether it's NBFCs, I think there's continued upside. Yes, some folks might say, okay, they're trading at 2.5, 3, 4 times book. But let's face it, why can't they trade at 6 times book as they did, frankly, pre-credit crisis, where some of these big names were trading at 6 times book? So my own view is, you know, valuation is one thing, but actually if an FII is coming to India and needs to create a core portfolio of stocks, and there are more and more FII flows, as we know, coming in, there are at least half a dozen banks, financial services stocks that have to be part of their portfolio. So yes, at 4 times or 3.5 times, it's looking expensive, but my own view is it can grow.
You worked in London, you worked in New York, you've got a global perspective in that sense. How is India being sort of marketed to foreigners right now? And how do FIIs perceive India? Because a lot has been made about the nature of the flows as well, right?
Yeah.
No scientific way to estimate it, but a lot of it is attributed to index flows, absolute return flow, the ETFs.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Almost made out to be sort of evil. Is that so? Just talk about that a little
bit. No, I don't think so. Actually, for the last 18 months or so, you know, obviously all of us are out with our clients in London, in New York, in Edinburgh, Singapore, Hong Kong, to sell either the India story or to sell specific corporates as part of these various conferences. Actually, what has amazed me is how little of the selling we've had to do. So if you're sitting sort of in the lunch area during a break in a conference, you've got the FIIs actually saying to you why they really like the India story. So I'm sort of sitting there saying, okay, I can sort of take a break, listen. So I think there's very much this sort of bought into the India story, the, you know, 8% GDP growth, the demographic story, saving, it's all there.
Right.
So actually all you're doing is saying, okay, this is why my particular stock makes sense. I don't think you have to convince them about India.
Okay.
It's just a question of relative value, X versus Y. So the selling is actually quite easy. You don't have to sell. Because if your product's good, which we think it is, it sells itself.
Are foreigners also quite discerning right now in terms of, or they just want to exposure to India first off?
Actually, the knowledge of sectors, the knowledge of companies, the knowledge of the management structure of these companies is actually, I guess, mesmerizing, gratifying, whichever sort of adjective you want to use. Their knowledge of these companies is actually quite very, very good. So they're just not saying, you know, go buy India, sort of buy. It's no, I want to tell me why this and why not that. So it's a lot more granular than you would sort of think from a macro perspective.
Okay. I just want to spend a bit of time on QE2, popularly known as QE2 now. How is that sort of going to influence and impact market returns here in your assessment? Not just India, I guess emerging markets like India, because a lot of the money is finding home, right?
Yeah, I think if you are of the view, as I am, that that pump, as it's, you know, 600 billion for now, pumps that kind of liquidity into the global markets, given the growth dynamics of emerging markets, a lot of that is going to flow into the emerging markets, of which India is a key component. Now, the question to ask is, between now and, let's say, the summer of next year, when I think actually they might start to withdraw stimulus, how much of that 600 is going to come? My own view is, I don't think we see a repeat of what we've seen in the last 6 or 8 months, which has, it could be as much as $3 billion a month, $3, $4 billion a month. I don't think you see that. So I think it tapers off, but some of that QE money, QE2 money is definitely coming.
You think there will be a withdrawal? 6 months, a year down the line?
From a liquidity perspective, yes. I don't, you know, this sort of buying or selling $75 billion of bonds every month, I think that starts to stop. Because if you start reading the tea leaves of the numbers coming out of the U.S., it's starting to look different.
Okay.
And whether it's, you know, the 25,000 difference in non-farm payrolls last night or whatever it might be, PMI, stuff that's happening
in
China.
Is it bad for India? purely from flows perspective.
Well, listen, it's weighing what will happen if there's a withdrawal of cash versus other geographies participating in macroeconomic growth, right? So where that balance lies, will the India story implode? Will there be a massive outflow of capital? The answer is no. So it'll be a little bit of one or the other. I don't think it's massively disruptive to the market for sure.
Okay. You're working to bring a lot of new companies to the market here in India as well. Talk about that for a bit. How are things looking? The kind of companies which want to make it to the listed space.
Yeah, I think if you go back, let's say you go back to the summer of July of 2009, when sort of the market reopened, right? It reopened with a couple of deals that we did, Mahindra Holidays being one of them. But a lot of it was about the deleveraging story, because the whatever leverage that you had looked to be excessive because your top line suddenly shrunk, whether it's a global firm or a domestic firm. So a lot of the equity raise was deleveraging. Now, most of the equity raise, at least what we are seeing,
recapitalization has happened.
Recap's done. Deleveraging is done. Now it's about growth. Now, growth, either organic India growth, inorganic offshore acquisition growth, it is largely about financing what appears to be an aggressive growth story. So there's been a massive shift from recap to growth. That's at least the mandates that we have and that we're in process is really about growth.
Is the pipeline strong as you see it?
See, we're new kids on the block. I've turned down 5 or 6 transactions because I just don't have the bandwidth at the moment to do it. But I've got 3 very large deals in the pipeline which will come to market in Jan-Feb after sort of the Christmas New Year break. And now that my team is starting to come, they're in situ, my ability to actually execute transactions is infinitely better. So I'm not worried about the absolute number of deals. I think that will come. People like the Religare capital market story. People like that there is an Indian firm who wanting to go global. They want us to succeed. There's enough goodwill in the community. Corporate clients have been hugely supportive. The institutional clients have also been supportive, giving us ideas how to sort of present our product to them. So I'm less worried about seeing the deals as opposed to executing them correctly. So as I say, in Q1 you'll see a burst of transactions from us.
What was Coal India's sort of marquee deal in that sense for the capital markets here as such?
Yeah, I suppose it was a, we're always sort of comparing ourselves to China where $5, $10, $20 billion are not out of the realm. So a $3.4 billion plus a green shoe was a landmark deal for us. And the fact that it was executed quite well, wasn't sort of the high point of the market, that exuberance that sort of caused everything collapse after, as we saw
in Jan 2008,
I think it was a terrific deal. Now it's unfortunate that bankers don't make money with all the work that goes into it, but that's a different story.
Will you relegate the next Coal India, whatever it is?
I would say in 2 years, because right now I need some P&L, right? I can't afford to do no fee deals just yet, but maybe in 2-3 years, yeah, sure, why not?
Pleasure speaking with you, Tharun.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for sharing your time. Thank you.